Okay, welcome to the City of Hueneme Museum. First thing I'd like to do is read the Presidential Proclamation, Commemoration of the 50th Anniversary of the Vietnam War. And this is by the President of the United States. As we observe the 50th anniversary of the Vietnam War, we reflect with solemn reverence upon the valor of a generation that served with honor. We bring tribute to the more than 3 million servicemen and women who left their families to serve bravely a world away from everything they knew and everyone they loved. From the I Dream to Khe Sanh, from Hue to Saigon, and countless villages in between. They pushed through jungles and rice paddies, heat and monsoons, fighting heroically to protect the ideals we hold dear as Americans. Through more than a decade of combat over air, land, and sea, these proud Americans have held the highest tradition of our armed forces. As a grateful nation, we honor more than 58,000 patriots, their names etched in black granite, who sacrificed all they had and all they would ever know. We draw inspiration from the heroes who suffered from unspeakable as prisoners of war, yet who returned home with their heads held high. We pledge to keep faith with those who were wounded and still carry the scars of war, seen and unseen. With more than 1,600 of our service members still among the missing, we pledge as a nation to do everything in our power to bring these patriots home. In the reflection of the wall, we see the military family members and veterans who carry a pain that may never fade. May they find peace in knowing their loved ones endure. Not only in medals and memoirs, in the hearts of all Americans who are forever grateful for their service, valor, and sacrifice. In recognition of a chapter in our nation's history that must never be forgotten, let us renew our sacred commitment to those who answered our country's call in Vietnam and those who awaited their safe return. Beginning on Memorial Day in 2012, the federal government will partner with nations and communities across America to participate in the commemoration of the 50th anniversary of the Vietnam War, a 13-year program to honor the most challenging missions we have ever faced. While no words will ever be fully worthy of their service, nor any honor truly befitting their sacrifice, let us remember that it is never too late to pay tribute to the men and women who answered the call of duty with courage and valor. Let us renew our commitment to the fullest possible accounting for those who have not returned. Throughout this commemoration, let us strive to live up to their example by showing our Vietnam veterans, their families, and all who have served the fullest respect and support of our grateful nation. Now, therefore, I, Barack Obama, President of the United States of America, by the virtue of the authority vested in me by the Constitution and the laws of the United States, do hereby proclaim May 28, 2012 through November 11, 2025, as the commemoration of the 50th anniversary of the Vietnam War. I call upon federal, state, city, and local officials to honor our Vietnam veterans, our fallen, our wounded, those unaccounted for, our former prisoners of war, their families, and all who served with appropriate programs, ceremonies, and activities, in witness thereof, herein unto set by my hand this 25th day of May, 2006. So that was from the president. Just to give a little bit of background here, ground operations began in Vietnam in 1965. The days of combat a tour was 240 days. Official circles called it the Vietnam conflict. We called it the Vietnam War. SEAL Team 1s, which the SEALs were set up to when Vietnam started, kill ratio was 200 to 1. 150,000 fled to Canada, joined the National Guard, or used educational deferments to avoid fighting in Vietnam. Total casualties from the United States, South Korea, Australia, Thailand, New Zealand, and the Philippines killed in action were 64,311. Wounded in action were 319,344. The city of, so that's some of the statistics I pulled for you. The city welcomes Captain Bill Hodge, retired naval combat aviator. Captain Bob Quinn, a combat CB. Master Chief Jim Daniels, combat CBs. Sergeant from the 101st Airborne, Dave Wilson, and Corporal Ron Montague of the Marine Corps. Before we start this event, which will be filmed and placed on Facebook, on the Facebook site of Fort Wayne Navy Museum and YouTube, after the program ends, we will ask the five veterans to remain at that time. We will take a picture of them to be used to make it part of a permanent memorial to this day. Each of the veterans has been asked to describe what it was like for them serving either in the skies or over Vietnam or on the ground in South Vietnam. We will start with Senior Captain Bill Hodge, then Captain Quinn, then Master Chief Daniels, Sergeant Dave Wilson, and Corporal Montague. Hodge is a retired aviator. Captain Quinn is a retired commanding CVs. Master Chief Daniels, a retired CVs. Sergeant Dave at the 101st Airborne. And we have one here, the PO2, Bill Daniels. Bill Daniels was wounded in action in Vietnam and died from his wounds. He's the son of Chief Daniels over here. We want to remember him. All the pictures back here are what we currently know of Hueneme residents who were killed in action in Vietnam. Okay. And so I'm going to turn it over to Captain. Bill, you just sit, please.
Oh, sit?
Yes.
I don't know if I can gesticulate myself. Larry said what my name was. Let me tell you about Larry. Does anybody here except for his wife know what Larry really is all about?
No.
Larry is one heck of a guy. He should be the mayor of Fort Wayne. Much rather work behind the scenes than in front of the scenes, though. But this room, without Larry, would still be a garage. Absolutely amazing, Larry. Heaven knows you've done a great job here.
Thank you.
Well, you know, when most of us stand up to relate our experiences, we talk about ourselves. I'm going to switch gears slightly and talk about some guy that I was in a squadron with. His name was Walter Sutton Wood. What makes Walt Wood so special is that he graduated from the military academy, not the naval academy, and became a naval aviator the hard way. Walter was a guy that was very unassuming. He was a guy that was very dedicated to his country, dedicated to the service that he ended up in, the United States Navy, and was an aviator nonpareil. He was quite a guy. When he was going to West Point, he decided then when he was in West Point, that he wanted to be a pilot in the military. But he didn't want to be an Air Force pilot, he wanted to be a Navy pilot, because he fell in love with carrier aviation. In any event, he finagled his way as a junior at West Point to become a candidate for the Naval Flight Training Program. In any event, he succeeded in doing this at the end of his junior year at the Military Academy. His senior year, he spent, and that was a program that was in effect at West Point for quite some time, and the Naval Academy as well. What they would allow these cadets to do is in their junior year is declare for the Navy. And conversely, the Naval Academy guys had changed their minds as they were going to school if the Naval Academy could declare for the Army. Although I don't know, I could never do that. Nothing against the Army. It's just that the Navy is the Navy. As the Army is. In any event, Walt Wood and I ended up being roommates at Pensacola when we went through flight training. Walt started out to be introverted somewhat until he got acclimated to the way the Navy did things. And then, holy mackerel, he jumped in with both arms, both legs, and really went to town. He ended up finishing second in our flight class, and as fate would have it, he and I ended up being shipmates in the squadron. That was in 1954. As time went on, Walt Wood became recognized throughout the attack community as one of the best aviators that they'd ever put on the floor and put in the sky. Well, in Vietnam, you take what you were dealt. And believe me, the deal was lousy. The only good thing we had to go for us was coming back to the carrier, which was clean. It was a decent way to go. In fact, I used to commiserate for my Army colleagues who had a good slog around in the mud. Another reason to be in the Navy. Sorry. In any event, the attack mission in Vietnam, and I was only in the attack community for 3 years. Aircraft by Douglas, the D stood for Douglas. Well, in any event, we had a mission. We're going to take out some fortifications near a bridge, and if possible, to get the bridge as well. Well, Walt was my wingman. We flew in very low altitude, and Walt, I was leading Walt in what we called in the Navy a section of two aircraft. And we hit the bridge dead on, except with several hits. The thing stood up well, didn't budge an inch. So as we mustered at 2,500 feet above the terrain, Walt said, "I had a bomb that was hung up. Let me go back and then get rid of that thing once and for all," meaning the bridge, of course, the target. So with that in mind, Walt went back in again. Walter Sutton Wood. He went back in, and before he could drop the bomb, he was hit. His plane exploded, and you know immediately, no doubt, no question, he was immediately dead. lordship later on, and he just about, the guys of lordship that were in the squadron all gathered around and couldn't believe that this guy would turn around and go back and pursue the mission beyond the call of duty. They had the target, they had a zeroed in, they being the Vietnamese, North Vietnamese. They had zeroed in on us. This was obviously a suicide mission for him, but he pursued it anyway. The point of the whole story is not that he lost his leg, because Walter Sutton was one of many, many, many people that got killed in similar fashion. But it's one I can personally relate to, and I haven't even talked about this in 30 years probably. But I can remember every detail. He insisted on the radio that he go back in. And I ordered him not to. He did so anyways. Anyway, Walter Sutton died, in my estimation, a hero. A big hero. Still hard for me to talk about. In any event, the bottom line was that we all realized that this guy went above and beyond what was required, above and beyond what his pay grade called for, above and beyond the heroic action he was taking. He did it because that's the way, and I remember living with him, how he thought, how he structured his life, and that truly was duty, honor, and country. Personification. So here we are, 50 years later, those of us that can still remember. And your mind has to go back and hearken to great guys that we worked with, that we flew with, or worked on the ground with, and lived and died together. Walter Sutton Wood. I don't believe in self-eulogies. I believe eulogies are better suited to people who deserve them, and those are mostly dead people. So, God bless you, Walter.
Well, you know who I am. Try not to remember it. It's a lot of trouble. We certainly have heard of a very heroic and true military action. And as we get to the gentleman at the end of the line, I think you'll hear some more of those. Jim Daniels and I we're the weird ones from the Seabees. Our motto is, we build, we fight. We're primarily builders. We are not infantry, we're not airborne, we're not Marines. We don't go looking for trouble, but if trouble comes, we'll take care of ourselves. So most of our experiences deal with things we built, operations we perform on the ground in support of the true fighting folks. I'm just going to give a couple of short examples of strange things. The movies talk about the fighters, the aircraft, the things they did. And when there were those bad guys shooting mortars and rockets into your camp, it was nice to have some aviators who would give them a hard time. But I arrived in Vietnam about April of 1967. Went from Travis Air Force Base by commercial jet. Landed at Da Nang. Middle of the night. No lights anywhere. Typically at that point, everybody stayed on the camp after dark, unless you were on patrol or something strange. So at dark, they shut the airfield down. Plane landed, civilian crew, they got out, they departed. Here's a plane load of sailors, Marines, soldiers, left on their own, no terminal lights, nobody to do anything. Fortunately for us, my brother happened to also be assigned in Vietnam at the time. He was an officer in the 30th CB Regiment, and I was coming in to be his boss. Navy screws things up pretty routinely. He recognized that terminals didn't operate at night, so he and a couple of buddies got a weapons carrier and a Jeep, and they drove in the middle of the night against all the rules to pick up his brother. And when they found all these characters standing under the wing of the airplane wondering what the heck to do, those young Seabees got on the plane, emptied all the bags out, lined them all up under the wing, told the folks, "There isn't anybody here, I can't do anything more for you, but there's your gear," and beat on that door over there, and eventually somebody will open the terminal. And then they threw me and my gear in the truck, and we went zinging across the dark spaces back to our camp. We were assigned to a place called Red Beach on the north end of Da Nang. There were two CB battalions and a regimental headquarters. Across the highway was the Marine Logistics. A beautiful place. I would love to go back when nobody's shooting at you. Beach as far as you could see on the South China Sea, nice warm weather. One Sunday we decided, you know, we're out here on a beach, why the heck don't we go swimming? Well, a bunch of us did. Water was warm, was lovely, till a bunch of sea snakes came swimming by. That ended my swimming in Vietnam. We had about a half a dozen CB battalions scattered around. We were building an airfield for the Marines at Chu Lai, building another airstrip and a hospital on the one side of Da Nang, an ammunition supply point, and a bunch of other facilities in other parts of Da Nang. And we had some activity going on up north. About 3 months later, we had moved so many more battalions in that one regiment wasn't enough to take care of them. So I'm one of those guys who got orders from one command to a different command in Vietnam. Most of the time you get orders and you get the hell out of there, but I just got to move closer to the DMZ, up at a place called Jale. We had been in Da Nang supporting the 1st Marine Division. Jale was the headquarters for the 3rd Marine Division. Big camp at Dong Ha. The folks that operated Kaesong, and there's a bunch of you who are mature enough to have heard those names before. These were the camps of the Marines that we were supporting. Kaesong was a lot of fun. I was the operations officer of the 32nd Regiment now, and had a battalion in Dong Ha, a partial battalion in Quang Tri, a battalion at Jale, and another battalion at Phubai. So we were doing all kinds of construction supporting the 3rd Marine Division. I spent 5 days a week roaming all the construction sites. I get back to the camp, I debrief the Commodore. He and I would debrief the commanding general of the 3rd Marine Division. The general would tell us what he wanted prioritized for the next week, and then I'd go out and spend 5 days roaming from site to site. I had a beat up piece of paper that were orders that gave me top priority on any transportation going anywhere. So I bummed rides on airplanes, on truck convoys, on landing craft going up and down the coast, anything that was moving in the direction I needed to go. So I'd leave camp, and for 5 days the boss didn't know where the hell I was. For all he knew, I was at the nearest Marine camp in the bar having a good time. Did happen to get a drink here and there. Some of the specialty jobs we had, at that point, they decided that the base at Dong Ha was just too close to the DMZ. It was within artillery range for the North Vietnamese. So Dong Ha got hit every day with artillery, mortars, whatever. One of the operations that got a little notoriety was they happened to have a good lucky hit on the ammunition supply point. And this is just a big flat piece of ground with tons and tons of all kinds of ammunition. Seabees didn't build it. We put earth berms around it. So theoretically, if you this pile of ammo blew up, it wouldn't blow all the rest of them up. Good theory, didn't work. Unfortunately, right next to the supply point was the Seabee camp. We had a few casualties. I don't think we had anybody killed, but we had a number wounded as this thing went off. It was like the 4th of July, 24 hours a day for 4 days. And day and night, shrapnel was raining down as all this stuff blew up. Interesting project. The Seabees were more concerned when it quit blowing up. Now they had to go in and clean it up and build another one. And what do you do with all this unexploded ordnance? That was just another one of the, remember, we're there to build. We're not there to fight wars. Decided they needed a new camp that was further south. General Westmoreland was in charge of all the military in Vietnam at the time. He said, I want you to figure out the furthest that the North Vietnamese artillery can shoot, and that'll be the north boundary of the new base at Quang Tri. And I expect to come up here and land on your airstrip in 30 days. Well, the site, I did a recon. The Marines were very reluctant to take me out and let me roam around on the sand for a while. Big sand dune between the road and the river. Indian country, the Marines said, we never even go here unless we do it in a convoy. And now you guys think you're going to build a base. Good luck. We needed it. We needed it yesterday. So I grabbed the CO of one battalion, MCB3, said, you're going to be in charge of this team. I grabbed the XO from another battalion, and the ops officer said, grab a small amount of equipment and a handful of people and get up there and start grading that site. We got up there and unfortunately found out that this was a burial site for the local village. All hell to pay. Thank goodness the local village chief was very, very supportive. And I've got about four bulldozers sitting here idling, ready to start clearing it off and level off the site. And the village chief gave folks like 30 minutes to clean out any graves in that area. There are no grave marks. They just know that Grandpa is buried here. They said, well, to move them, we have to have red paper and a wooden box. So one of my little jobs is find reams of red paper. And we got every empty ammo box the Marines had within 20 miles. And within 30 minutes, they had a piece cleared, then they moved the next piece and the next piece. And we just kept moving and wound up leveled the site off. It was all basically sand. The folks that I sent up there put up a shelter hat. They give you half a tent. You better have a friend gives you the other half, otherwise you're sleeping there with a half a tent. The Marines provided security. Their biggest pitch is we cleared land so fast they couldn't move the barbed wire fast enough to stay out of our way. And of course they're trying to protect us. And every day I'm sending more people, more equipment. I'm not sure how many folks the Marines finally put in there. But our guys worked from dawn till dusk. When we had enough of them there, we actually put floodlights in. We worked 24 hours a day. We leveled the site off, building a short temporary airstrip. Got it set. You can't do much on a sand dune. So we then had to deliver truckload after truckload of bags of cement. Just think about it, you know, a bag of cement, I forget whether they were 80 or 90 pounds. Got this runway 100 and some feet wide and 7,000 feet long or something. Took those bags of cement and lined them up side by side, covered that entire thing with sacks of cement. Broke them, spread the cement. We then sent in some huge rototillers, basically. mixed the sand and cement, and came through and sprayed water on it, mixed it again, and then ran rollers over it. Made a sand cement base, and then put the temporary aluminum airstrip on. On the 30th day, General Westmoreland landed a C-130 on that strip. Our guys are getting shot at, mortared every night, every day. They just kept going. Before the strip was finished, we actually had mobilized another battalion and brought them in. They took over all the construction at Quang Tree, and I let the folks I borrowed go back to their own units. But that's the kind of typical things we were doing. We lived pretty well compared to the infantry and the ground troops. One thing we did is build what's called Southeast Asia huts. World War II, we built Quonset huts. We didn't build Quonset huts in any number in Vietnam. Southeast Asia hut is a bunch of plywood and a hell of a lot of 2x4s. And you'll see them around, and if you haven't seen one, but figure you really need to see one, go over to the CB Museum. We've got a section of one over there. Absolutely nothing fancy. Nothing was painted, nothing was polished. A framework of 2x4s, one side with a sheet of plywood. A lot of open space, you needed to get air movement through it. It was basically to keep the rain off. Didn't do much of anything else, sure. Wouldn't stop shrapnel. You had to have a pit for it, but it was clean and dry. In the Da Nang headquarters, we had a super mess hall, young Vietnamese ladies who cooked the food and served it. I think a bunch of our guys fell in love every day. There were some very, very pretty girls working there. We didn't have any of that stuff up at Jolly. Brand new unit, they were still figuring out what the heck they were going to do with us. But I've talked long enough, we need to hear from the folks who really fought wars. I had a great time. I hope someday to go back, because Vietnam is a beautiful country. And when people aren't shooting at you, it would really be a great adventure. I did get a chance to operate with the Army my last couple of days. We'll tell you that in some other event. But we got shot down, they got blown up, and about a week later, they finally got me out of there and sent me to Japan for 2 months so they could glue the parts back together. So I survived, and that's as close as I got to combat, and as closer than I ever want to get again.
Things that Bob covered, and we were out there together. He was with the regiment, and I was with the battalion. Well, I went into the CBs when I was 16 in 1942. I had 2 months of arguing with my father. There was nothing for me around my hometown, and I definitely would never go into a coal mine. After 2 months, he finally signed the papers that I was 17. And I came into service into Cape Perry, Virginia. And there were 1,300 and some of us men and officers. No boot camp. And my boot camp was barbed wire entanglement, field fortification on the Yorktown River. Then when it was raining and snowing, almost every day, we'd go in a big building and teach us how to use the wooden machetes, how to use them to fight them. And we busted down into 3 CBM units, and we came here, and I turned 17 here at Hueneme. And we'd have to go overseas, and 2.5 years later, I'd get back, and after 7 hours, and I was on doing construction work. And I reported in here, met my wife here the 14th of February, married her the 24th of May. We were on 30 days for our 53rd anniversary. But I enjoyed my 26 years and 3 months. I made Master Chief and was going to get it when we got back in the country. But my son, when they gave him his medical for retirement, he's going to have to learn to walk all over again. The way both his legs were tore up and his one arm. So I went ahead and retired and turned it down. And in 2008, our commanding officer from Fort Magoo, Captain Connors, the Master Chief there, some way they rigged it for at CB days, I could be promoted to Master Sergeant.
Oh,
our,
right at the wrong service, Jim.
But, so the Vice Admiral that gave me the certificate and everything said, you can be called Master Chief, you can wear it on your uniform, but you cannot get your ID card changed, and you cannot get any extra pay. So that's how I wound up being Master Chief. But I put two tours in at the Equipment Operator School. One of them turned in for three of us, a 5-year tour. I went to battalion and was just getting ready to deploy again when the Marine Corps Major pulled me out of my outfit to be the Legion Chief in military training of the 5 battalions that we had here at the time. And I spent more time at Camp Pendleton than a lot of the Marines that went to Camp Pendleton. But I was down there quite a bit, lining up training and birthing spaces and chow even for our bivouac. And I enjoyed my 26 years and all, but I never had a high school one day. I graduated from the 8th grade. I had a good education my 7th and 8th year, and I advanced regularly in the military. Then I decided to be an instructor. I had to have a GED. So when I was stationed in Arizona, I took either 5 or 6 tests and passed them and got my GED. The next time I applied for orders, it was instructor GED. Received that. But then after my second tour, I got orders in CB-8. And I wound up being Legion Chief of the Alpha Company. On that tour, they augmented us, they were roughly 54 men for the work that we were going to be doing. And I run into the captain here from time to time. Time to time, on the base, and I enjoyed my 26 years. My son went into the CBs, and he was on his second tour to Vietnam. And he called me and talked to me a couple times. And one morning, they called me to run over to Shack there, right quick. My son wanted to talk to me. I got on the phone and he said, Dad, Captain called me forward this morning and promoted me to E5. I said, what? I said, you only got 19 months in. He said, I know it, but I was recommended for it. He promoted me. Then 4 days later, he got hit with a rocket attack through the door of his truck. And his captain called the captain of the outfit I was attached to. That our outfit was going to relieve. And I made arrangements to get out of there at 7 o'clock the next morning to the hospital ship and got to see him and knew that he was coming home and he was going to be okay. It was just going to take time. And while they were getting cleaned up, because that was the night they overran 5-3, and they had more Marines coming in there that was injured worse than he was, and they had to get them first before they could get to him. But he was still black all over when I first got to see him. Then I was on deck waiting for him to get him all cleaned up and all his wounds were bandaged. And the chief came up when we come down to their quarters and they were going to have to move him. And I knew the senior chief where I previously met him in my knee. And my son had spent a week in his house. So he had went back with me and my son remembered me. So he said, I'll keep a watch on him while he's still on board the ship here. Then we served our time out. During the 9 months we came back. I decided to retire. And I went to, got hired in the school district in management, and I had 11 schools and 48 people working for me. And I did that for 17 and a half years. Then I went on the council, served 8 years on the city council. But all my work that I, things that I did, all the time I was stationed there, was the things out in the community. The chief of police, I bought the house next door, got me involved in everything in the city. And so, and I'm still involved. But I enjoyed my time in service. Just had a reunion. And a lot of my men that worked for me that were there had a chance to visit the staff. But there's pictures up here that Larry had talked me out of getting them, so he put a squid out there. Thank you.
I really don't need this microphone.
No.
Good morning.
Morning.
Isn't this a great day to be on this side of the grass?
Yes.
Why don't you do me a favor? You've been such a wonderful audience and sitting there nice and quiet. We'll just stand up for a second, let some circulation get going, then we'll continue with our stories. If you don't know the person next to you, introduce yourself. And you could probably tell, not only am I a Vietnam veteran, I'm also a pastor. And so that's why we had a little greeting session there. And I pastor an Oxnard Bible Church, been pastoring there for 15 years, which is just past 5 points in Oxnard. When I was younger, we moved about every 2 years. I was born in Mineola, out on Long Island. And we moved up to Massachusetts when I was 12 years old. My freshman year of high school was in Marlboro High School, Marlboro, Massachusetts. Then we moved to Tucson, Arizona. So my sophomore and junior year, in high school. It was at Rincon High School in Tucson, Arizona. And then in 1965, we moved to Ventura, where I worked in the cucumber fields outside of Santa Paula. So I am a farm laborer. Yeah. And I graduated from Ventura High School in 1966. When I graduated, my dad told me I'm out of the house. I could go to the military or I can go to school, but I'm out of the house. I can be home, it doesn't matter. I'm out of the house. Well, 1966, the Vietnam War was going on. And from my dad's stories of the military, if there was, I don't care what your MOS is, which is a military occupational specialty, if there's a way to put you in combat, they will figure out how to do it. And so I figured I was going to go to Vietnam and I wanted to be best prepared. So I went to the Marine recruiter because the Marines are the best trained out of basic training. Simplified. How many Marines we got here? All right. Okay. So the Marine recruiter says, well, you need to be in LA at 5 o'clock in the morning. Well, I asked, well, how do I do this? Well, that's your problem. So I went to the Navy. And I went talked to the recruiter, got a great job lined up. He said, all right, now you need to be at LA 5 o'clock in the morning. I said, well, how do I do that? So that's your problem. So I went to the Air Force. I knew not to go to the Army, but anyway. I went to the Air Force. Great job that MOS I could get. You need to be at LA 5 o'clock in the morning. How do I do that? That's your problem. So I finally went to the Army recruiter. And got a nice MOS as a communication specialist. And then I saw if I could get $50 a month extra if I jumped out of airplanes. And so back in the day, $50 was a lot of money. And how it worked, you only had to jump once every 90 days. So I got $150 for jumping out of a plane. All right, once every 90 days. And I thought, that's gonna be really good. So I just want you to know, I asked the recruiter, well, what goes on? I said, well, can you be back here at 5 o'clock tonight? I said, well, I can do that. Why? He said, well, we're going to put you on a bus. We're going to take you to L.A. We're going to put you up in a hotel. We're going to buy you dinner. Then we'll get you breakfast. Then we'll take you over to the induction center. So customer service got me to the United States. We have the honor and privilege. I am also the president of the Vietnam Veterans of Ventura County. And for the last 29 years, we've been going into over 24 public and private high schools and middle schools, sharing our Vietnam experience with our PowerPoint presentation to students, mostly junior and high school junior classes. For instance, at Moore Park, we have talked to over 400 students each year at Moore Park High School alone. And Miss Abby at Anna Kappa Middle School in Ventura just loves to have us come, and it's just really great and to be there and share our experience. And usually it'll be myself, or it'll be also with a Marine, a Blue Water Navy, some Seabees, and we have this one gentleman from the Air Force. And we're sharing our presentations, and I'm showing how I went to Vietnam. I went to Vietnam with the 101st Airborne Division. I was there from December 1967. I was part of Operation Eagle Thrust, which was the single largest military airlift to history at that point. And the 101st Airborne Division still has the distinction of being the only division that was actually airlifted right directly into combat. And so I was there December 67. My welcome to Vietnam baptism was Tet of 1968. And the first weapon that was shot at me was a 50 caliber machine gun. You never forget what those bullets sound like. And so that was my baptism. I was at Benoit for Tet. After that, we moved up to what would become Camp Eagle between Way and Fubai. And I really appreciate the Seabees so much, because what they did, they cut out all these trenches that we put our tents in. We didn't get that, any of that plywood stuff, all right? We got a tent, but at least it was in a ditch, all right? Which was great until we got the monsoons. And then we were all flooded. But anyway, I think that was just the Seabees' sense of humor. Anyway, I stayed in Vietnam until April of 1969. And my MOS eventually became Tactical Communications Chief. So when I was around 21 years old, I had 15 men in my platoon that I was responsible for, and I was responsible also for the communications of a battalion level communications in the 101st Airborne Division, all the helicopters and everything like that, and that's a huge responsibility, because you can't call the dust off if the radios don't work. Amen. And so I got to do that, but as an NCO, I also got to work other patrols outside the wire, looking for tunnels, spider traps. Also, if the infantry, we knew they were going to set up an ambush outside of our perimeter at night, we would actually, during the day, sweep that area and look for booby traps that the North Vietnamese or Charlie left there, so they could come in at night and set up their ambush. So, did a number of things. But we're sharing our experience in school, what's going on and what we're all doing. Ron Fitzgerald, our vice president, was on the LSD, not the drug, but the but the ship that launches the Amtraks, and that Marines know what I'm talking about. And then we have a number of CBs, some Marines that were up at Dong Ha that you mentioned, there Richard Camacho and others, and they talk about how you couldn't fire into the DMZ, but they could fire at you, a number of things, which don't get me started on the rules of engagement. I think it's stupid to have rules of engagement in a war. Either you do war or you don't do war. But you don't have rules, all right? Anyway, all right, I'm over that now. Thank you so much. Got that off my chest. Anyway, we're doing our school presentations, and Ed Cheferia, who's the gentleman in the Air Force, does his slide presentation. And we talked about how, like, when I was in the 101st, I mean, I would go maybe a month, 2 months without even a shower. Which you didn't want to shower, because if you go outside the wire, if you shower or anything like that, Charlie can smell you. Okay, so you've got to smell like the rice patties and everything else. You don't want to smell good, in other words. I don't remember even having a toothbrush the whole time I was in Vietnam. Most of our meals were out of sea rations, out of cans and that. And so the Air Force guy, Ed, is showing us that they're sitting down. We have bunkers made out of sandbags that we have to fill. The Air Force had concrete bunkers that were poured by, guess who? Yeah. CBs. All right? They didn't do that for us. They did bring the sand, though. They did bring truckloads of sand for us to fill our sand. Thank you very much. We did a lot with all the branches, with the Marines, worked with the Marines, worked with the Navy, and it was just really great. The esprit de corps and the ribbing that you see we do here, but when we were there, it really didn't exist. One of the things I really, really appreciate when I did get to go to Da Nang is a thing the Navy has called mid-rats. I love mid-rats. And whenever we got to Da Nang, captains of the ship would just welcome us on board, and we get to go down and have their midrats and have a real cooked meal on the table with plates and flatware and stuff like that. And so it was just really great. They even let some of the guys shower aboard ship, and it was just really great. So we had a really great camaraderie with all the branches of service while we were in Vietnam. One of the things that we did once we went to Camp Eagle, 101st, we tried to relieve the pressure that was on caisson. You might know that they were pinned down during 1968. And to the Marines' credit, they never gave up, they never abandoned the base, they stayed there. So most of our operations of the 101st were in the Oshawa Valley. I don't know how many saw the movie Hamburger Hill. All right. That was actually the second time we were there. I was part of the first time we were there in that area. But that's in the Oshawa Valley. And again, it was trying to release some of the pressure and disrupt the Ho Chi Minh Trail in that region. Well, back to the slide presentation. We go through the whole slide presentation. I'm seeing plates, flatware the Air Force has. You know, he had it really bad one night. A rocket blew up one of their planes. And that was his combat. You know, we were getting rocket mortared almost every night. You know, and so we get done with the thing. And then we have a question and answer with the kids. And one of the questions that one of the kids asked it, if you could do anything over again, what would you do different? Talk to Ed. I would do it the same. Talk to the Marine. Wouldn't you change a single thing? Talk to Ron, the Navy guy. Wouldn't change a single thing. Got to me. I said, yeah, I would have got my lazy butt down to L.A. at 5 o'clock. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ron Monjo. my family's here, my neighbors and fellow veterans, everyone here. My name is Ron Monjo. I joined the Marine Corps in July 1967. I was trained out at MCRD, which is Marine Corps Recruit Depot. I then went to Camp Pendleton. In December, I was sent to Vietnam. I arrived in the middle of the month of December. I ended up, I actually flew from the United States over to Okinawa and then from there to Dong Ha. And that's where my rear was at the time. My first part of it was at Cam Lo. We did a lot of walking with our backpacks, of course, with food, with salt tablets, because you had to take salt tablets every day because of malaria, prevent from getting malaria. And our backpacks were loaded down also with extra ammunition. At the time, I was an 0311, which happens to be a rifleman. As time went on, I ended up being a machine gunner, and I never did work on 106 howitzers. I was in H&S Company, which is Headquarters and Service Company. Anyway, I'm in Dong Ha. They moved us to Cam Lo. We're traveling through Cam Lo. All of a sudden, we get the report about going to Khe Sanh. I was transferred to Khe Sanh. A little bit hard for me to talk. We were under fire. We got this fire. I never realized what war is like. You know, when you're a kid, you watch the John Wayne movies and everything. But we were pinned down, and they were firing rounds at us right and left. And thank goodness for the Seabees, because they had actually built trenches and put tarmac, which are steel things that they used to use to fly planes off of. And that was one of the things that really kept us going, because other than that, I don't think I'd be alive today. It was horrifying. It's a real change in life. It allowed me to understand what war was really all about, especially this particular war. After we got on a case on, managed to escape from there, we were dropped by helicopter. CH-4 Chinook 646s, you've probably seen a picture of them or seen them if you were. It's got a back door that lowers down to the ground and you get out. And so they would drop us there and basically tell us to fight our way out of it. That happened a great deal. Now, something I need to bring up is the fact before the Vietnam War, Vietnam was at war. And what happened was that they built subterranean structures, including hospitals, sleeping quarters, which we knew nothing about. We're new to this country, we know nothing about it. So anyway, we would have to send guys down below through these holds to find out if there were any of the enemy down below. We did a lot of, at night we'd send troops out, and including myself, I'd been out several times, going out to try and research where the enemy was and how far they were from our positions. Now, when I say this, I'm saying in the general sense, because I was dropped on a lot of hills. Up in the northern part where I was at, by the DMZ, there are a lot of hills up there. There's some flat areas, but most of those are all being used for rice paddies. That's where they grew the rice. And of course, I'd walked through the rice paddies before. But I was primarily on hills. And for the most part, that we were fighting our way out of it. And then as soon as we got the area cleared, we would take the bodies of the enemy, we'd stack them up and napalm it. And we lost a lot of men along the way. Some guys I never really had a chance to get to really know. Some of them went home because of rotation, and others just simply didn't come back to the field. At that point in time, when I arrived in Vietnam in January or in December, I was a POC. Within 1 year, I was a corporal. In April, I helped two guys find their way back to our camp. They had lost their way. I don't know how they did it. My sergeant got upset with me, but the major overrode him and told him what I did was very good. Then I helped save two guys. I was promoted at that point to Lance Corporal. But throughout the year, it was just one battle after the other, and a lot of bad memories along the way. I got to tell you, every veteran that's been in Vietnam knows that it was an unrecognizable war. We went out there just trying to do what the government wanted us to do. And we wanted to be faithful to our country, but yet we were really undertrained, honestly. I don't think even the government knew how terrific it was over there. In November, we got hit on the hill, and I don't know what happened, but I was totally out. I woke up, and I found myself on the hospital ship to repose. And I stayed on there, and the only reason why I knew the date, because throughout that year, I had no idea what the dates were. You just don't keep track. It's just your, all you're doing is just trying to get through it all. It's enough just to get through every month of the year. And the only reason why I knew it was November, because I happened to be on the hospital ship during the Marine Corps birthday, November 11th. And I was almost ready to go back, and they came up and presented me with a Purple Heart. And I told them I couldn't take it back with me because I needed to get back to my unit. And I told them I had too much stuff in my backpack to take that, which included extra socks, utilities, things to keep you dry, because during the monsoon season, you don't know what rain is until you've been through a monsoon season. And of course, during the summer, it gets really hot and very dry. But so I was always full of supplies, and if we didn't take any extra that we could, mail was just, you were lucky to get it. If you got it once every 3 or 4 weeks, you were really lucky. And food, we lived off of sea rations the whole time. And whatever we didn't eat or didn't want to eat at the time, we saved up because we didn't know when we'd get food again. Because when you're under fire, they're not going to send any CH-46s in there or anybody else. You're on your own. During the time I was there, I saw an F-4 fire plane get shot down. Saw a Chinook 46 get shot down. And of course, the casualty rate was really high. Not only for the Vietnamese, but for us. And I did it for my country, but I still have fond memories of the guys that I was with. And I gotta tell you, it was one remarkable time. I still have a lot of memories of it. When I was out in the field, they asked me if I wanted to stay another 13 months, re-up for another year, and my answer was very clear to them. And so they got me out on a jet helicopter and flew me out of country, because you have to be out of country within 13 months or I don't know what the price would be to buy. They'd have to pay, but I finally found myself in, at that time, by the way, they had moved it from Dong Ha to Quang Tri because Dong Ha was shut down. It was getting fired upon and everything, but anyway, I ended up going to Okinawa and then flew back to the States. And when I flew back to the States, I entered a very uncomfortable situation. When we got off the plane, there were people shouting and yelling at us.
Yeah.
And after everything we had been through, I felt so unfair. I can't begin to tell you.
They didn't know.
They had no idea what we were trying to do over there. And all they could see are the pictures, because it's the first war that was ever really photographed. And they didn't realize what we were going through for the sake of the people of Vietnam. And honestly, some of the people in Vietnam really didn't want us there either. So it was a very difficult time for me, but I gotta tell you, I'm glad to be an American, even though I was born in Canada.
City Council would like to give you these city pins.
Thanks.
Thank you. And thank your wife for the dessert that she put up there. Captain Bill?
Thank you, Larry.
Bob.
Thank you, sir.
All you guys are great. I got three little stories of my adventure into Vietnam. First one was when I went in country of Thaksinut. I got in there and nobody's there. And Cap can relate to this. And here I am, I've got all these greenbacks in my pocket. Nobody's supposed to have greenbacks in the country, you're supposed to have MPCs, military pay certificates. So all these guys are offering me these phenomenal amounts of money to get my 20, you know, my greenbacks. And I'm like, oh shoot, I got a phenomenal deal. Although I sold all my greenbacks. Gosh, that was, I learned later that was taboo. You know, because they were ending up in all the crooks' hands that were in the South and were looking to get out. My other experience was I was in a special operations group attached to the National Security Agency. And it was a spook unit. It was eerie. One of the things was I walked into this vault, and we were sealed in. I mean, our job was if anybody comes through the doors, to blow the place. And I get pulled over by this captain, and he says, "Downing, so much of looking around with all these guys, and there's 9 officers in there, and little old me." He says, "You see every one of them? They can't wait to get out of here. And it's like, every day's a happy day to you." And, God, that stuck with me to this day. And the other thing was walking down, because I'd been to Antoy, Phu Quoc Island, Da Nang, and then back down to Saigon. As I'm walking down what they call Trong Dao, which was the main drag, when I first got there, it was a French boulevard loaded with all these trees. And because of all the trucks going down from Newport docks through, they killed all these trees. So I'm walking down, and that's all you did was walk. And here comes these, I think, T-28. Right down the middle, and they were Arvin Air Force. And I can remember thinking, oh, no, blank, we got another coup. And until you saw this thing, I mean, they went right down for the where the Vietnamese assembly building were. So that's some of my memories. But I want to now thank each one of you. And I want to remind each of you to go outside so we can get a picture, because we're going to do something special, okay? And then the other thing is I want to thank Councilman Tom Figg for being present. Mayor Pro Tem John Sharkey. And I'd like to do something a little bit special. Could the Vietnam veterans in the audience stand up, and I'd like to each one of you to introduce yourself and pass it to the next guy. Would that, could the Vietnam veterans stand up that are in here? Holy moly.
My name is John Klopstein. I retired with 20 years in Vietnam. I spent about a year and a half off and on in Vietnam. I was fortunate enough to be an air crewman on P-3s, and we flew up and down the coast. So it was tough. Thank you.
My name is Ellis Green, Petty Officer, Second Class, United States Navy. I served in the military, as did my grandfather, my father, and his brothers, and my brother, and my sister. At that time we grew up, it was an honor and a duty to serve your country. And your country was proud of its servicemen. But like the speaker earlier alluded, one of the things the Vietnam veterans found out that we were not welcome back in our countries by some folks. In fact, we couldn't wear a uniform in a lot of places in our country. The only time I wore my uniform on American soil when I wasn't on duty was at my father's funeral. And so we're, the thing that we're most proud of is our own service, our own duty, and we're proud of how the Americans now treat our veterans with pride and honor. And that's something that kind of overlays my experience. Thank you.
I spent 21 years in the Navy Nurse Corps, and I was in Hueneme in 69 and 70. Being an operating room nurse, I was on the front line.
My name is Bill Stewart. I went in the Navy December 13, 1943, retired in 1979. I was an enlisted hospital corpsman in World War II, a gunnery officer in the Korean War, and a dental officer in the Vietnam War. And in between all that, I served on 7 ships. And we put 5 of our 7 children in the military. Now they're retired. We now have 2 at the Pentagon.
My name is Ben Ardanowski. I retired in the Navy. I joined the Navy to fly, not to fight wars. I couldn't afford my own airplane. They gave me a $200 million airplane, P-3, for about 12 years. The SPAD, 2 years, 7 aircraft carriers during that. Had a lot of fun flying from one carrier. Well, did a lot of flying. And my first flight was at 19 years old, and I was co-pilot on an SMB. And both engines quit on landing at Floyd Benefit. I think the guy in the left seat was a chief pilot. He wanted to see whether I was scared or not. I wasn't. I mean, the ground was coming up pretty quick, and he got a restart. He did it on purpose. That was my first flight, and I flew till age 52 as an air crew. And I was qualified when they eased me out. They told me I didn't have an airplane, and that hurt. They had airplanes, but I got old. So it was a lot of fun, and the guys that didn't make it back are in my book, a lot of them. It took me 18 years to write it, and it went online in June. And they're not dead, they're in my book.
My name is Oscar Garza. I went in the Marine Corps in 66, along with 19 of us from the same high school. I was in Vietnam in 67, 68. And what we did in Vietnam, where we had to do what we had to do. If I had to do it again, I'd do it again. Simplify.
My name is Tony Murguia. I was living on Dill Street, I think, in Dill Street on in July '66 when I got this letter that said greetings from the President of the United States, and I thought that's kind of a trick. So on 20 July 1966, 32,000 folks, young men, were called to service. Ventura County sent 4 truckloads down to AFE's LA. I was one of them. I wrote a letter to the editor, and it was published on 21 July this year, that said exactly that, folks in Ventura County, myself and Port Hueneme, answered the call. My job in Vietnam, I was an infantry platoon leader and company commander with the 1st Air Cav. I commanded Alpha 2nd and the 12th periodically because our company commanders kept getting bumped off. But as a platoon leader, we went out on ambushes and we killed folks and we dispatched them to their makers and came in the 50 tons of rice, and that's another story. But I had 57 combat assaults in a UH-1 helicopter and 7 in a Chinook, CH-46. A little different, but came home, worked in, I won't buy a Michelin tire, because I worked with Michelin rubber plantations outside Quan Loy and Onlock. Rice is difficult to eat, but now we grow it in California, so I'm okay with that. And also work jungles. So bamboo vipers are cool people, and they like to bite. Interesting side effect, about 48 years ago, I think it was 48 years ago, I was in basic training, just finished AIT, in fact, at Fort Ord, and my girlfriend showed up, and my folks brought her up as we went to a place called Crusoe Corners in Seaside, and told my folks, who are still living on Gill Street, that we were getting married, and my mom offered me a car. If I'd think differently of the situation. Last week, Linda and I celebrated our 49th anniversary. Wow. After 6 years on active duty, I spent 19 in the Guard. I retired out as a lieutenant colonel. And so I'm very proud of my service. Got wounded 3 times. Only got awarded once, got nominated for a couple of other things that didn't happen because a helicopter got shot down, but it was fun. I enjoyed my time in service, and I thank you all.
I'm John Ferrito, and I was a captain in the Air Force, and I got to Vietnam in about December of 67. And I was assigned to Tan Son Nhut. And a few weeks after I got there, we had Tet. And I want you to know, I took it personal because they knew I had arrived, and it was all because of me.
My name is Ron Watts. I was kind of like you. I went down to join the Air Force when I was in college. And I had to go up to LA. My own arrangements, I guess, so to speak. And I thought about 4 years, and I thought, eh, that's not for me, so continued with my education. My mom gave me a call, and they said that, you got a letter. And I said, start out reading. Yep, and I said, okay. So I got the free bus ride to LA, and a little side story, my dad was a military, what we used to call lifers, and I called him sir. He was a CB, this was his last duty station here. He served in World War II, Korea, and Vietnam. So, pretty proud. Anyway, I was up at Fort Ord, and came back home one weekend, and went in the den, turned the light on, and my dad's sitting there. I go, what are you doing here? And he goes, your turn. And about 3 weeks later, I got my order. And I went over there. Originally, I was sent in country, I went to Benoit, landed there. Once again, you know, you're by yourself, find your way up to Fubai. You know, where's Fubai? Well, figure out a way to get there. So I did, and I got there, and I was there 2 weeks before anybody figured out I was there. And eventually they caught up with me, so to speak, and gave me an assignment, and I worked logistics there. We were in convoys down to Da Nang and back. And then they decided I'd be better served by going down to the 1st Infantry Division, which was down to Lai K and Zeon. So I went down to the 1st Infantry Division, and they thought it'd be nice if I took on the assumption of the line of duty investigator, which means that I researched and, I went out and determined the cause of death or injury for anyone that was not injured or deceased from a hostile fire. And that's what I did, and it was kind of interesting because a lot of people don't realize how many people are victims of non-casual, you know, enemy fire. And so anyway, I did that, and they liked what I did. They gave me the Bronze Star, and I was there from 67 to 69. I extended my duty over there, so when I came home, I wouldn't have to do 5 months here. I stayed over there 2 months longer, so I got early out. So when I came back home, I landed at Travis Air Force Base in Vietnam one day. Next day I'm in Travis, here's your shower, your steak dinner, I'm out on the street. And like you, I went to San Francisco Airport. Interesting story. I sat there by myself, everybody else sat over there. So, you remember that. And, you know, the thought I had was, you know, I don't know if you remember, I'm going to be back with my buddies. You know, I don't know who these people are. You know, my buddies. That's where my heart was. But anyway, I do know how you feel. And but that's all gone by the wayside now, and I think people are starting to understand what we did over there and why we did it. You know, we did, you know, I was a draftee. I did it because my country called me. And my dad probably would have shot me.
I went in country in 66 and stayed through 69, and you guys should be proud of me. I came back. I went to Vegas to celebrate, and then I flew back to Dallas, Texas. Folks didn't know I was, or my dad picked me up at the airport, and wore my uniform, and we pulled up, and I wasn't used to driving anything fast. I mean, I was sitting there, and I was like holding the dash. But we pulled up to the stop sign outside of Arlington. And a guy next to us, because I was in uniform, pulled the bird. Well, I was nobody to mess with in those days. I pulled the guy out his car window and used his head for a basketball. And my father's, I could see my father, he was panicked. And then I realized what I was doing, got back in the car, and we went on. So that was me. So again, I'd like to thank all of you for being here. This has been a special occasion. I'd like to remind you that next Friday is Veterans Day. There will be a ceremony at City Hall on Ventura Road. Council Lady Bromley will be there, Kathy Long, Tom Figg, Jim Hensley, and most of the program will be on veterans. We're including the Boys and Girls Club, the Junior Naval ROTC from Hueneme High, the Ben Morrell Battalion from the CB base. So we're trying to make it a real community start. Of course, we'll see you there, Bill.
Starts at 9 o'clock.
The following, starts at 0900, 9 o'clock in the morning. And the following, on the 19th, we have a special event here for World War II veterans. And we're gonna have quite a number of World War II veterans. I anticipate we'll probably have about 30 of them. So this is gonna be a rarity. And a number, fellows that will be speaking up here that weren't will be like Chief Daniels, who just doesn't like, he loves war. He's been in every one of them practically. And then we've got Orvin Carpenter, WW2, and Korea. And then we've got Lieutenant Colonel Pierce and Corporal Ron Nichols. And God forgive me, my memory fades me on the fifth person. But they're going to be here, and they're going to do a little talk. And then the WW2 veterans are going to be here. And the Port of Hueneme has graciously stepped up, so they'll get a little sandwich or something that day. Compliments of the
Port of Hueneme. And
a musician, the World War II music. Yeah, and we're going to have a fellow that's agreed to play World War II music for us that day also. So again, I hope this doesn't run too long for you. The video is going to be part of history of what these guys said, because it's things that would be lost. So thank you.
I apologize.